Welcome everybody to the joint webinar, Develop Industry 4.0-ready OPC UA-enabled products presented by Toradex and Matrikon. Before starting the webinar, please pay attention to the following notes. This webinar will be recorded and available within a week in the Toradex website, www.toradex.com/webinars. Throughout the presentation, you are able to ask questions using the webinar tool. In the end, we will host a Q&A session where the questions will be addressed.
My name is Leonardo Veiga, and I am an FAE from Toradex Brazil. Our guest from Matrikon is Derek Kominek, and I would like to thank you, Derek, for being with us today. Toradex is a company that develops and sells highly reliable ARM-based system on modules. We focus in reliability, long-term maintenance, and scalability. But we deliver more than just the hardware itself. Toradex has in-house VSP development, and therefore we provide production-ready Windows CE and Yocto-based Linux, which are maintained over the product lifecycle. Since one of our pillars is customer focus, we deliver an experience focused in ease of use, providing premium quality support, and a wide development ecosystems. There are some numbers to give you a sense of the scale of Toradex. We're 15 years old, have over 3,000 customers and 100 employees. Our presence is global across 9 offices, and we have an extensive partner network. Toradex has a direct sales model, meaning we don't sell through distributors, and therefore our global presence makes us in direct and close contact to our customers. Our local offices across the globe enable us to provide high quality local support and local stock, which gives you competitive advantage if your product also has a worldwide presence. And here are some use cases where Toradex is inserted. And notice that they require highly reliable and cost-effective solutions. In addition, those markets are competitive and demand that you release products with a fast time to market. Our hardware offerings are composed of two computer module families, Apalis and Colibri. And Apalis focuses high-speed interfaces and the most powerful computing capabilities, whereas Colibri is the best choice for industrial connectivity and low-end devices. Within a family, the modules are pin compatible, enabling you to easily migrate your applications, be it for a module with greater performance, cost optimization, or end of life. And this is the introduction I would like to give you all about Toradex. And from now on, I would like to hand over the presentation to Derek. Welcome, Derek.
Great. Thank you. Hello, everybody. So my name is Derek Kominek. I am the consulting manager at Matrikon, dealing with the OPC UA toolkit and some of the other products that we that Matrikon puts out. So as introduced, today I'll be talking about overall industry 4.0 applications and basically how OPC UA plays a role within that, and also basically the one of the best ways for you to get started with using the technology. So it's my pleasure here to be on the webcast with Toradex. They're one of the preferred vendors for us as far as having computer and module type stuff applications created for the creation of applications on that. That's one of the partners that we recommend to work with. So to get started, when we talk about IIoT or Industrial Internet of Things the Industry 4.0 as it's referred to in Europe, basically the entire digital business transformation is affecting all aspects of the businesses, basically globally. Now, when we talk about the industrial sector, where we deal with either process control, which is more like the refineries, et cetera, or the manufacturing aspect with discrete manufacturers, the increased connectivity that's available, the visibility down to the shop floor and sort of the smart systems, that really, the visibility into that starts to affect everything throughout a business. So whether you're talking about R&D, manufacturing and production, like I said, the sales, marketing, everything starts to be obviously connected, and therefore business can move a lot quicker because the business side is much more attuned to what the production capabilities are able to do. So some of the drivers for this, whether it's production efficiency, process reliability within that, you know, either the plant or benchmarking how, you know, multiple plants are doing at the same time, and supply chain optimization, all of those are affected. You know, there's a very broad range of you know, reasons why people use industry or are adopting the technology from Industry 4.0. But in the end, you know, you have to keep these systems secure, and there's the importance is how you actually establish the communications with the underlying systems. So once you get the deeper visibility into these various assets that are available in a business, then of course, you know, each of the specializations start to, you know, recognize their own benefits. So, you know, if you're talking about process reliability, you can then start to look at doing overall asset surveillance, the predictive maintenance, and also just getting guidance, for example, from third parties who gain visibility into your premises or onto a customer's premises, whoever's just using it. Production efficiency, so operator effectiveness, being able to optimize the overall process, quality, reducing waste, and then optimization. So planning and scheduling, inventory, and working with the broader sort of supply chain. So a lot of different business cases for why the greater connectivity is so important, and sort of how, whether you're doing, or people are using the greater visibility for their own processes or for connecting with other businesses for the supply chain, all of those in the end come down to the need for the ability to connect the systems down in the shop floor. So, you know, from let's say early on in this, let's say presentation, you can see that, well, as we start to dig down into the shop floor, obviously the devices that sit on the shop floor have to have also the improved capability for communications and doing so securely, and also being able to pass that data in context. So the more systems that you connect to, the more you need to have more of the modeling or the metadata that comes with them, so that as you climb that information higher into the enterprise, you're able to better interpret what that what the data represents. So then when we talk about, you know, things like big data analytics, things that are happening up in the cloud, you want to make sure that the data that's coming up from these devices has sufficient context to make it possible to more easily or more accurately analyze it and get actionable results from it. Okay, so this is where we start to introduce or talk about OPC UA. That's where it starts to show up, because when we talk about data connectivity, so visibility, context, security, etc., as we look at that, we're basically dealing with the edge or fog computing. So again, the types of things that you do with the data, and then we climb up and start to also need to get that information up into the cloud or on premises, for example. So it could be either off-prem or on premises, or just even throughout the enterprise without necessarily talking about the cloud. There's different levels that you can employ this on, but the concept that shows up around Industry 4.0 or Industrial Internet of Things, it requires the same capabilities for the data connectivity and what you need from it. Okay, so as far as how these different initiatives or eras, if you want, are rolling out, Industrial Internet Consortium is one organization started off in the States. They are international. They do, you know, they have expanded throughout the world. Industry 4.0, which is the manufacturing focus that started in Germany. It's a German initiative, German government initiative, very focused on manufacturing as it started off. That got adopted, of course, in countries throughout Europe and also expanded into Asia. China has its own Made in China 2025 initiative. Also, they talk about Internet Plus. So around the world, actually, the organizations have started to look at how do you put all these different systems together in an organized fashion as different vendors try to interconnect. Because, of course, just because you have, let's say, cloud connectivity doesn't mean that now suddenly everything understands everything else and that understands the context. So to enable that to actually be functional and in an efficient way and in a secure way and a robust way, these organizations are defining a lot of parameters around that. Now, one of the keys is to say, okay, well, if you're going to connect to things and, you know, it's not enough to say you have Ethernet connectivity, you have to choose sort of a foundation for how are you going to build, what are you going to build on top of as you have, you know, literally thousands of different devices that come from different vendors, and they all have to sort of share in this you know, entire environment that gets woven by them connecting amongst each other and higher level systems. So the question is what type of communication standard could be used. Now, this is something that the Industry 4.0 group looked at. Again, that was the government, the German government. And they did extensive testing to look at, well, so what could serve as the one standard that could sort of unite the different communications or create a platform for all these systems to communicate with each other and yet also be secure enough and robust enough to express the data within context, etc. And what they, after running this study, they basically came back and said, well, actually OPC UA is the only one that actually has the sort of the robustness and the security needed for the broad range of applications in industry that are required in order to implement Industry 4.0. So basically became a pillar for that. And that the same goes actually for the other various, you know, consortiums or groups. OPC UA plays a key role in enabling the overall system to run by facilitating that type of connectivity. So here I took a snapshot from actually the Industrial Internet Consortium's architecture. They put together sort of a diagram that helps to visualize, you know, when you look at the different network layers as you climb from the physical going upwards throughout the, you know, link, network, transport, etc. It shows at each level what are the key sort of pillars for enabling a full-blown IIoT system. So in different applications, you might have different uses for things. So for example, DDS often shows up, which runs also on various transports. And then eventually over, you know, once you get below IP level, there are different, again, carriers or transports that you use. It runs on top of. And if you look at this, then we see that OPC UA is one of the core four standards. Now, in industrial or in manufacturing origins, that's exactly, you know, that's the part that has been identified as, you know, you use OPC UA. And then there are different variations, let's say, in the transports that it sits on top of. So whether that's using, you know, the pub/sub type standards, so using MQTT or a UDP, or you're using just the direct sort of TCP/IP, you know, binary communications, all of that sort of runs. There are different options that can be used by OPC UA as a framework for establishing the communications. And then down below, of course, we have just your usual sort of wireless or wired networks. TSN, which is a popular topic of conversation these days is also very important, and OPC UA can run over that as well. And that's for more the deterministic communications, which starts to be, of course, increasingly important as you start to connect lower and lower into the control systems, where you start to have high-speed critical data, for example, when you're doing motion control and such. So that's how the stack sort of lays out. So when we're having this conversation about putting smart devices or creating, building an industrial Internet of Things, systems that have, you know, embedded applications, the idea becomes you want to have those devices being able to take part in this conversation, and therefore they basically need to be able to talk OPC UA because you want them to talk natively. That's one of the advantages for, you know, having embedded systems actually natively communicate over OPC UA. You therefore don't necessarily within your plant or your factory or out in the field, you don't necessarily need additional hardware, additional PCs to act as the middleware in order to facilitate these communications. You can actually talk directly to the device, or the device more typically will be able to talk, you know, upwards either into the cloud or into the enterprise on its own, right? And that's sort of the whole point of this. Okay, so the criteria to have these, you know, to be one of the four core frameworks that they like they show here from the IIC, you know, I've shown them on the right. Won't necessarily read through all of them, but the point is you have to meet a lot of different criteria, like being secure and performant, etc., in order to actually be the pillar. So that's what OPC UA achieved. So let's talk about OPC UA. There's a lot to talk about in it. It would take we run entire courses on it, so there's a lot. But if you were to take the top sort of, you know, three or four highlights, they would be the fact that it's an open platform, that it employs strong data security, and that enables interoperability in, and then I sort of broke this out here into two, interoperability from a data perspective and from a services perspective. So those are the key highlights sort of why OPC UA is important, and I'll dig into each of these now as we go. So let's start with open platform. OPC UA will run on basically any hardware platform that is, that, let's say, has enough computational capability to actually just establish the, you know, the lowest level type of communications or the smallest systems. So OPC UA scales. It can go from an embedded system that's very small and basically just issues a single value, you know, at a time, or only can handle a single connection to it, to systems that are, you know, extremely robust, and they literally run millions of transactions per second on full blown, obviously, server or workstation type PCs. So that's one thing. Also, OPC UA is operating system agnostic, so it will run on basically any operating system. As a matter of fact, it also runs on bare metal. You can implement it on systems that basically you fire them up and they basically just run in a, you know, infinite loop through a single main system. The other aspects of this, as far as being an open platform, OPC UA is obviously you can, let's say, mesh it or blend it with various connectivity standards, and it also will support various protocols, or at least it can translate between them. So in that sense, when you bring all that together, that's why it's basically an open platform. When we talk about security, again, extremely important in when we talk about IIoT, and especially when we hear about the various hacker attacks that happen and the malware and et cetera, it's extremely important that the systems that will be sitting in the field or in the plant are resilient and not only don't get taken down easily by, let's say, even a denial of service attack, Of course, nothing can withstand a denial of service attack indefinitely, but the efficiency that's built into how communications are established between two different client server pairs or two different OPC UA parties, definitely there are things that are put into the standard that basically allow a server, for example, to very quickly discard connection requests that are invalid rather than spending processing time trying to figure out if it should or should not allow the connection, which then, of course, allows it to be overrun easily. So whether it's from an attack of that form or from just establishing the actual trust and using sort of the best practices in the security industry, using certificates and, you know, the sort of the handshaking or the steps between how the two parties actually establish that trust, all of that is actually built right into OPC UA as well. And this was actually tested by third-party testing to validate it, especially when we're talking about the industry 4.0 effort. They actually did that testing. So data security, extremely important. That's why it shows up as one of the keys. Now, when we talk about the ability to do the interoperability, I use kind of a small example here of what that, to illustrate sort of what that does. So let's say you have an OPC UA client, which is shown in the top box, and it wants to, so it's the one that actually actively will go and communicate with different applications or different devices, which is shown below, may expose or may model their information or organize it in a particular way. And of course, when you start to connect with a UA client, so let's say you have an OPC UA server on board here, which takes however this native layout of the organization of the data is set up, it expresses it as an OPC UA information model. And all that really means is that OPC UA is flexible enough to maintain the relationships and between the different nodes or the different objects that are defined natively, but it just expresses them in the OPC UA, let's say, format. The reason that's important is now any UA client that connects to the device still gets the context of the information that's shown or that's laid out in the device, but it does it through OPC UA. So of course the client can work with that structure and the context. So therefore that, you know, the relationship is preserved. If you have a UA client then connecting to another device, again, data might be organized in a different way. Again, it has the references or the relationships between those different components maintained, even though it's expressed through OPC UA. And of course, a native OPC UA system would just naturally have that as well. So the point is that when you bring in all of the different systems and you start to connect them, it's not only the ability to exchange information, but actually to understand the context of the data and the relationships internally of that data. And that's what this does. So the other side of this is that you can also have OPC devices that expose services. So imagine that you've got different devices which have various functions that they can perform. So they have data, but they also have software functions they can execute. So now when a client connects to different vendors' devices, even though they may code the behaviors differently and they may have data structured differently, if they support OPC UA, then basically they can expose the commands that they have on board as services within the OPC UA framework, and they also have the data that's available. So now the client can equally talk to both devices using a standard set of, for example, services, and also work with the data in a standard fashion, even though the devices themselves, if they don't natively only use OPC UA to structure this and expose the services, they will have underlying native services that just get mapped or translated through OPC UA. So for this reason, when you talk about Industry 4.0, and again, you have lots of machines and machine builders providing systems, they can standardize on various information models, which are then exposed. So again, they can do what they want with their system on board and how they express the data and the functions, but to the world, they expose it through OPC UA, enabling other systems to directly communicate with them. All right, So that's I know it's a very fast introduction and high level, but at least it should give you sort of the flavor for the breadth of what OPC UA is capable of, both from sort of the like I said, the security perspective, where it can run the variety of systems, and also what it actually provides as a value from the data side. So now let's take a look at some differences or some of the advantages when you talk about OPC UA. So again, it's scalable, you can run it embedded, and therefore it could be, you know, devices can have this basically natively put into them. So if you're working on specialized products, so you're putting this on an embedded system, you will probably have it pre-configured. It's a purpose-built device, so the entire information model is already provided. You turn it on, off it goes, and basically the connectivity and the functionality is already up and running. It's available. So it reduces sort of the amount of time it takes to actually set one of these systems up. Of course, then there's no PC setup in that case. It can also be PC-based, like I said. So, I mean, you can go and run millions of transactions per second. The Matrikon FLEX toolkit, that's what we provide for developers. If you're running that on just a standard business laptop, we've done a million transactions a second using about maybe 60% of the CPU. So it scales quite nicely. But at the same time, we also run it on the smaller systems, like the ARM-based ones. And again, it works efficiently at that level as well. So it goes in both ways. And as far as the ability to communicate, again, even though the device might be embedded, you start to have options. So whether you're going to be using pub/sub down the line, or publish and subscribe, which is more sort of the cloud-centric method of communicating, where you're publishing data out, you don't necessarily require the listeners to interact directly with your system, or you're using more of the client-server architecture where, you know, the consumer of the data actually directly talks to the device or the system that has the OPC UA server, and they exchange bidirectional information. So either way, it's flexible enough to provide both. It's very resilient to communication disruptions. So especially for systems out in the field, even though you may lose connectivity with between the client and the server, if you're doing it that way, you can still regain or reestablish that connection without necessarily the applications themselves, having to go through extensive cycles of trying to reconnect. Okay, so I mentioned companion specifications, and just in brief, the information modeling that's available in OPC UA. And again, this is a core part of the value that OPC UA provides. So, and this box in the center there, when you look at the bottom, you have the OPC UA meta model, and then that built-in information models that sit on top of that meta model. So basically, this is the core of what OPC UA defines. These are the base types that would be available, and they're quite extensive. OPC itself has been around for over 20 years, very successful standard in its first generation. They learned a lot of lessons on that when they came out with the second generation, the OPC UA. So the types of information that are typically exposed in industrial systems, a lot of that base type stuff is already available within the standard. But the real strength shows up by the ability to actually build an object-oriented information model on top of that. So basically, extension of the types that the standard supports is possible by creating additional types from the base types. When you do that and you standardize a certain set of definitions, that's what you would basically call a companion specification. So that gives you a companion information model which various vendors in a given industry or for a given application can agree on to say, okay, well, we're going to use that particular companion specification, and therefore everyone is playing by the same rules or creating the same contextual information, even though, again, like I said, the underlying systems might express it or organize the information differently, but they have a consistent information model that they expose to the world. Okay, and there's a lot of effort happening on that. There's actually going to be, you know, in the Hanover Fair, for example, the foundation is going to be, OPC Foundation will be hosting a sort of a sub-conference where basically they'll be showcasing about 20 different organizations that are running these various types of working groups that are defining the companion specifications for their industry. So in Europe, you know, VDMA is a large organization. They have, you know, for the machine builders, there's a lot of different companion specs being built. That's what this is based on. So yeah, that's the, as mentioned, the OPC Foundation has a lot of different organizations that it works with. And this will be broken out by either low-level modeling for specific buses or high-level modeling or even entire verticals like for oil and gas, subsea systems with MDIS, WITSML, PACML, et cetera. So the various organizations break out into these different sort of categories by type, and you can get a lot more information on the OPC Foundation website for that. Okay, so when we take these information models now and we say, okay, so how does this actually apply in the real world? So let's say you've got a robot arm and it's got various types of information that you need to know about it in order to understand what position is it in, what state is it in, what tools does it have attached, etc. So what you do is you basically would represent to work with the digitization sort of, or the IIoT view of things, you basically want to create what you would consider a digital twin, which basically just means a digital representation of those key pieces of data on that system and the relationship between them, so that you can then manipulate the physical system in the cyberspace. And therefore, we call those the cyber physical systems, right? So the physical system is actually represented digitally, and then the digital twin is what you interact with throughout the plant, and that of course reflects back on the hardware how it behaves. So you would have, as the diagram here shows, for the robot you may have a model for the various types of information and the components that it has, and of course data values that are associated with each of these. So if you bring those together, that's how you would then say basically you've got this digital twin, which basically means the key pieces of information that define it are now, you can interact with those to have a complete view of what that system is doing. And imagine, of course, if you've got manufacturing cells and you're handing product over from one manufacturing cell to another one, as sort of the factory is assembling this thing. And of course, when all these different systems can communicate amongst each other using both the services and the data, as I said, that OPC exposes, you start to build a more autonomous, or enable a more autonomous way of running the factory, because they can actually share context and information between each other. Okay, so basically when you build that model, what happens is, in the case of what we're talking about here, if you want to create an embedded system where you're going to have some kind of embedded controller, the Matrikon FLEX, the toolkit for, that's our toolkit for building OPC UA-enabled applications, enables you to write this type of code, to work with this type of data. And that, of course, would sit on one of the Toradex computer on a board chip, or the modules, which would then, of course, do a particular action on the system. Okay, so that's sort of how it fits in. So one of the advantages of this, of course, is that when you're putting in various systems on the shop floor and you're exchanging them one from the other, when they are OPCU enabled, again, you can, if they're complying with the same standard, then, or you're getting them from the same vendor or different models, you can very easily incorporate them into your system, and you have a consistent way of how they express information and how the overall system will work. So it actually simplifies how you set up your shop floor. Okay, so let's talk about implementation. If you look at the OPC UA standard, it's a large standard. It's got 14 parts, sections, a lot of different conformance units. If you were to actually break out what are the requirements in order to certify such a system, and basically there's a lot that you have to implement just to build sort of the infrastructure for it. So one of the ways to make this easier is to implement is to free up your developers' time to focus on the applications that you're developing for your particular device or application, whatever you're taking to market, and to basically use a professional toolkit that implements the entire stack and provides higher level functionality for working with OPC UA rather than trying to build it up from ground up. Basically, nobody really goes and writes their own. Unless you want to be a vendor working with OPC UA, you basically would end up using a toolkit because otherwise you're literally, it takes years to actually build the entire toolkit up to use the full capabilities of this and then get it certified and then build your applications on top of it. So for that reason, Matrikon, we typically have standardized for the, we've been around for a bit over 20 years as well. We traditionally produce the actual end user software for working with OPC. When OPC UA showed up and we saw sort of the extent of this and how everything is actually shifting towards embedded applications, we took years to actually develop the OPC UA toolkit. Its main purpose at first, or our first primary focus, was on embedded systems. There are a lot more restrictions that you have to deal with, and therefore you have to go sort of to the first principles for embedded programming to actually build solid embedded applications, and then we scaled it upwards. So when you're looking to get started with the building IIoT sort of ready products for your own systems, what you would do is, again, you choose a platform, and then basically the toolkits would provide the underlying OPC UA communications, and you would build your application on top of that. So scalability is important. The size of the footprint, depending on what type of system you're running on and what type of resources you have available. And also you want it to be easy to use so your programmers can very quickly get through this, through the development aspects of it. So basically Flex runs sort of in both directions. You can scale it, and it actually, depending on the target environment that you're building for, the toolkit itself will change what gets compiled into your application as you blend it in with your application, as you basically code against it. So if you're going to be working on a system where you have multiple cores, you're going to be doing a lot of multi-threaded sort of large system behavior, the toolkit will include certain aspects of itself. If you're working with smaller systems, going to very small, et cetera, it will, again, choose different options, right? So, this fits very well into what Toradex provides. The different lines that are available from Toradex are, they work really well with this sort of setup. So when you talk about, having some, let's say, limited resources compared to full-blown PCs, large systems, but still having, embedded Linux running on their various RTOSs, real-time operating systems, or maybe dual OSs, that's something that that's available on here. So Flex sort of works well hand-in-hand with that type of environment. So basically it's quite easy to sort of take that as a package to use the Toradex supplied computer on a module, and then at the same time the Matrikon Flex OPC UA implementation. Okay, so if you were to be able to zoom in and take a look at what you've got running on a board, on a Toradex board when you implement OPC UA, basically if you were to look at the top, your application will sit above obviously the OPC UA server. The Matrikon Flex toolkit will take care of allowing you to manipulate and work, set up and manipulate the OPC UA address space in the dynamic fashion. It takes care of providing you with actually OPC UA server functionality. So the nice thing there is that you don't actually have to then write your own OPC UA server, at least the OPC UA portion side. All you need to do is provide the mappings to where your application is storing its own data that you want to expose. And then basically our toolkit will do the actual OPC UA server functionality itself. And then that's also sits over our OPC UA server stack, which takes care of sort of the lower level communications, which then plug in or tap into your TCP IP stack implementation and et cetera. That again comes with the board and the operating system that's running on it. Okay, so that's sort of how the Flex Toolkit positions itself, and then your application goes above that. So literally the steps for implementation would be that in the, you know, as a first step, you're writing your own code for your own application. You include the library that comes from Matrikon, so that's the Flex. Then you basically compile that entire project into the executable, which then gets downloaded onto your platform, your board. And again, within that, you've got the information that's available within your application. So the variables and et cetera are where they actually exist. That gets mapped into the address space, and that's already done, right? That's what you did when you were coding. So the server will use references to whatever you've got in memory. And of course, through conserved space, it's just using pointers into the actual memory space where you've got your data. So you're not duplicating anything. You're just pointing at it and organizing it through the OPC UA address space structure. And then all the other subscriptions and monitored items and things that you're actually working with in the OPC UA context, all of that is actually handled by Matrikon Flex, and then that communicates externally. Okay. Now, one of the things to note here is that, you know, that given the complexity of OPC UA and the capabilities of what you can do with that, you don't, even if you're using the toolkit, if you're trying to go to market as quickly as possible, and also to minimize sort of the development cycle and some of the learning loops that you're going to go through, if, you know, your developers are starting to work with this, but aren't necessarily conversant, or that's not, you know, their day-by-day job to actually work with OPC UA development. It's also quite useful to work with expert integration partners. So, for example, Toradex and Matrikon both work with BE Services. They provide these types of assistance, if you will. So, you know, working with people who spend a lot of time already with OPC UA and specifically specialize on, for example, using the actual toolkit like Matrikon Flex, that really helps to sort of get you focused on, or allow, again, your development staff or efforts to either get assistance or to actually, you know, have that portion implemented and therefore go to market that much faster. So something to consider, that that type of assistance is also available. And actually the sample implementation of OPC UA on the Toradex systems was actually created by BE Services, and that's available from the Toradex website as well. So that's just something to keep in mind. So if you were to look at, once you implement OPC UA and you want to, you know, take a look at what would that kind of look like onboard a device. So let's say, you know, you've got the little Toradex self-bouncing robot or something else that's actually more industrial, where you actually, you know, got some kind of, you know, whatever, hand picking arm or conveyor belt controller or whatever the application is. Basically, what would happen inside is you've got the program logic and the actual application on the device itself. That will have its shared memory space, where basically the information that's required to work with, you know, whatever the application's doing sits. And then basically on that device, you will have the ability to communicate with various systems. You may use other third-party protocols, obviously, so OPC UA doesn't in any way conflict with being able to use other protocols on board the device if it needs to support multiple ones. But if you do have OPC UA implemented, then it will, of course, work with the memory that you have on board, or where you're sharing the information from your application. And that then exposes that interface so that you can have then, for example, a client connect to your device and start pulling the information. That's what's shown here from the left to the right. Other systems that might be, for example, PC-based, they also will implement various protocols. And if they have an OPC UA server, obviously they'll talk to a client. You can also establish connections between, obviously, them and your device and et cetera. So the whole idea is to allow all the various systems to communicate with each other. But again, sharing context in a way that they each can recognize that follows certain basic criteria or kind of a common foundation of how you express that context. And that's what OPC UA lets you do. So basically, that's how you would go about implementing OPC UA on board your system on your on the computer on a module if you're exposing that through through an embedded sort of PC environment. So this one of the interesting things with this is that this is a very popular option for not only the large players, let's say, in the market, but basically if you're dealing with the mid-tier or small-tier producers, when you're not necessarily creating, hundreds of thousands of units per year or millions of them, but actually if they're smaller numbers, you're a smaller shop. Machine builders often fall into this category. This just makes it easy to, get the right price point, let's say, for the type of hardware that you're using, and at the same time, quite easily get, a top-level implementation of OPC UA that can run on top of it in order to basically make your system, whatever the application is that you're building against, making it easy to enable that for the Industry 4.0 sort of broad application. Or it basically opens up the market for you because you now are able to communicate with sort of using the default language, let's say, that's used in IoT type applications. Okay, so that takes me to the end of sort of the overall presentation on what we talked about, Industry 4.0, or overall the movement, OPC UA, as far as why it's become such a powerful or such a popular standard based on the power that it's got sort of built into it, and then how you would actually go through and start to implement that on your system. So that's it. So I guess we can shift into our Q&A.
Hi there, Eric. Thank you very much for the introduction to the Matrikon FLEX OPC UA solution. We've had a few questions here during the webinar, and some of them are related to Matrikon, other to Toradex. And to begin with, let's see. Basically, there were a few iterations regarding security.
Yes.
And the OPC UA standard. Do you have any comments about how is the security layer implemented in the OPC UA standard? Is it implemented on top of TCP IP stack, or is it specific to the Matrikon FLEX SDK?
Oh, okay, I see. Yeah, the OPC UA standard defines how obviously how communications are set up, how you establish trust between the different parties. All of that is part of the spec. So the when you're using the Matrikon toolkit, it's absolutely it implements what the standard calls for. So the libraries, and basically, just to be clear, even within that, vendors are free to choose the implementations of the stack, that they want to use. So if they're going to use Mocana or they're going to use any of the other commercial cryptography stacks because they, for example, have encryption hardware also on board, or they're just using software libraries, that is all open. So that, of course, does sit on top of TCP/IP or on top of Ethernet. That's, you know, the OPC UA is based on Ethernet, but the how you actually establish the trust and how that sits above it, absolutely, that's built right into the capabilities built into the stack. But people are free to choose their own implementations of the cryptography toolkits that they, you know, prefer to use, or depending on whether you're running on a Linux platform or Windows, you can choose, you know, you have different options. So the Matrikon toolkit, the Flex toolkit, does not in any way limit you from choosing one or another. Hopefully that answers the question.
Thank you very much. Actually, I think it's a good answer, since the question also talked about hardware cryptography support, which some of our modules may have.
Perfect. Yeah, then you could access that directly. Yeah.
Good. Thank you very much. And here's another question. This one, I think, is more direct. The question is, how difficult or what is the effort to get the Flex stack running on Toradex hardware?
Oh, yeah. It's actually quite easy, and as a matter of fact, they're already, like I said, by working with partners like these services, I mean, they've already created some of the references to see how that runs, but basically it will run directly. So it's more of a question of setting up your tool chain that you're going to use for the environment that you run, let's say even on top of what Toradex will provide for you. But as far as running on Toradex, there's no effort for that. We've already done implementations on that, so we can tell you that, you know, this is why we prefer working with Toradex, because there is no issue to run it on the board. It's just more of setting up your tool chain and actually building your application.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I agree with you, and from the Toradex standpoint, we have a lot of documentation in our developer website, and I was also browsing Matrikon website, and it seems that you also have plenty of documentation. So, yeah, it looks quite easy.
Exactly. Yeah, and actually, the nice thing is that there's an example that you guys have on your site, which, you know, as we mentioned, was built assisted by BE Services, but basically, there's already an example of how to get that done from your website. So the manuals plus the example, I think that really lowers the bar for, you know, the difficulty of actually setting this up or getting it going.
Yeah, maybe I can try to get the screen sharing so I can show this example to people who are willing to test it, actually test in our hardware. So, perfect. Probably here's my web browser here, and we actually have this partner demo image. As you said, it is provided from BE Services and implements a OPC UA server. If you access the main developer website and go under the software tab, you can choose the Toradex Easy Installer, and this image will be listed right away. So with a few clicks, you are able to test the implementation in the actual hardware. Okay, now let me see other questions here. One of them is regarding cloud support. Does Matrikon Flex OPC UA has any out-of-the-box cloud providers integration?
Okay. Yeah, so the nice thing there is that we're not tied to any integrator in particular. So basically, you're open, you're free to implement your, if you do have a, you know, whether you're going to be working with Azure or something from Amazon Cloud or Google or whichever, the communications that you're going to be establishing, they're basically open. So OPC UA is obviously agnostic to that. Our toolkit is also agnostic. So basically how you're building your infrastructure in the cloud and communicating downwards, that's open for whatever implementation you're building.
Thank you very much, Derek. Here's a question that says, what profile, what footprint, and what facets are available using the Flex OPC UA stack?
Okay, great, good question. So yeah, so the when we talk about, you know, profiles, when you look at OPC UA, as I mentioned in the beginning of the presentation, OPC UA can run on different types of hardware, small, big. So there are different classes of OPC UA servers that you can build. Either meant for really small or medium or large or really big systems. So the nice answer is that basically Flex will support all of them. So whether you're trying to build things and work with real-time data or historical data or alarms and conditions, or you're trying to build complex information models or commands, all of those are supported. So basically, if you don't have to implement all of them, and depending on your application, that might not make sense to try to implement all, or you're trying to build a large system. So whether you're building big or small, it can be quite easily configured to identify what functionality you want, and then you go from there.
Thanks. Okay, now let me just browse here through the questions and find another. Okay, this one is more about the Matrikon stack, and it is, can I combine hardware specific security blocks such as cryptography acceleration to the Matrikon OPC UA solution? Derek, can you please help me on this one?
Sure, for sure. So yeah, that's a great question, and yeah, absolutely. Just as OPC UA in general is platform agnostic, our toolkit is also platform agnostic, and not only do we support it, but we encourage it that people have, if you really want to get the serious cryptography performance and solidity, a lot of times the hardware that you would use for acceleration and doing the computations is definitely supported. So whether you're using software libraries or of choice or you have hardware, all of those can get hooked into, we just need to know, what the sources are for those capabilities, and that perfectly integrates with the Flex toolkit.
Thank you very much. And another question here is, how difficult or what is the effort to get the Flex stack running on Toradex hardware?
Okay. I could probably grab that one as well. So it's actually very easy. Number one, as Leonardo showed, we already actually have examples for you, so you can see how an implementation was made. But key thing there is that the hardware, everything that's provided by on the Toradex side, that basically facilitates or creates an environment that allows you to implement the OPC UA server or client that you want to build on it. So aside from setting up your tool chain, which is what you'll actually be working with, and different vendors, different programmers will have different preferences and such. But that's really the setup that you do. But as far as working with the actual Toradex system, it's very easy. This is actually one of the reasons why Matrikon works with Toradex as one of the preferred partners, because again, it's complete, and we also get a lot of good documentation. So the path forward is quite clear.
Thanks, Derek. I'd also like to add that it's really about documentation. Toradex has a comprehensive developer website, and I've browsed through Matrikon documentation, which is also very comprehensive and very easy to understand. And in addition, of course, you can always look at our common partners and ask them to help you with the implementation.
Well, those are all the questions for this session of the webinar. Therefore, I would like to thank you very much for being with us today and providing this overview about Matrikon FLEX OPC UA.
Oh, you're most welcome, Leonardo. Thanks. Thank you for having me on here.
And I would also like to thank the audience and have a nice day.
Great. Thanks a lot, everybody. Thanks, Leonardo. Bye, guys.